Took over 20 minutes, guys.
Captain, four popular warbirds are on an intercept course.
Oh, God.
We're being hailed. The commander wishes visual contact.
On screen.
This is Commander Starius of the Invictus.
Hi.
Commander, we were responding.
Explanations are unnecessary, Captain. We thank you for your humanitarian response to the Infinitus distress signal, and we recognize that you destroyed the rogue warbird in self-defense.
Good.
We will overlook violations of treaty this time.
How kind of you.
Captain, we have discovered a mutual threat. A race of beings that seems determined to manipulate a wide variety of life forms that call themselves the Brassica.
Yes.
If you have encountered them, it may be in both of our interests to exchange information.
Spock, transmit all we know about the Brassica to the Romulans.
Should we? I don't know if we should.
I've heard the name, but we know next to nothing about them. I don't think we can help you. Brassica? I've never heard of them. Spock, transmit all we know about the Brassica. I've heard the name, but we know next to nothing about them. I don't think we can help you.
Yeah. Hopefully they don't all attack us now. Should have saved.
Perhaps if you come across this information, we can share it. Please leave Romulan space as quickly as possible. The longer you stay, the more difficult it becomes to ignore this incident.
Understood, Helmsman. Set course for Federation space.
Okay. Here we go. Is that the end of that?
This day is not going well.
Captain, we have an emergency message from Starfleet. Code 1.
That's a planetary catastrophe.
Notice our shields went up.
Captain, a very large alien ship is about to land on the planet Atavus in the Klingon neutral zone. The aliens stated that they intend to land in the midst of the capital city. Then the ship cut communications with us. Since then, all attempts to contact the alien craft have failed. You are the closest starship to Atavus. We want you to evaluate the situation and safeguard the colonists. We need you to make contact with the aliens.
Hmm. Okay.
Atavus is located in the Klingon neutral zone.
Again, we're going in neutral zone.
The Federation won the colonization rights for that planet as per the Organian Peace Treaty. Both Federation and Klingon ships are allowed there.
Oh, okay. Atavus, huh? Can we save the game? That would be great.
Save new game. Replace previous game.
Atavus, right?
Atavus. A small colony planet in the Klingon neutral zone near the Klingon border. Both Klingon and Federation ships are allowed in this entry as the Organian Treaty is in effect.
Neutral zone.
Neutral zone. Two regions of space bordering Federation territory are neutral zones. One with the Klingon Empire and one with the Romulan Star Empire. By treaty, no ship is allowed to enter the Romulan neutral zone. However, the Federation and the Klingon Empire may compete to develop planets in the Klingon neutral zone as specified in the Organian Peace Treaty.
Huh. I wonder if it tells us details about each one. Oops. Nope. Okay, have we looked at this here?
Romulans. Warrior race believed to have descended from common heritage with that of the Vulcans, but one that did not reject passion and aggression as the Vulcans did. Under medical examination, the two races appear very similar. However, Romulans exhibit a psychological profile contrary to that of Vulcans. Romulans currently use ships of Klingon design, suggesting to some, Klingons are maintaining the Romulans as a client state to antagonize the Federation in a move that circumvents the Organian Peace Treaty.
Hmm. And Klingons?
Klingons, a humanoid life form whose home world is Kling. Klingons' culture is based on the principle of survival of the fittest, either through guile or physical force. Principles of honor permeate the culture, belief system, and actions of the Klingon race. Negotiations over planets in the disputed area have been slowly advancing, hindered by recent Klingon technological exchanges with the Romulans.
Who's this guy that we were talking to? Guyon? How about the... This is the ship that sent the distress call. Nope. Alright, that's it. Then we're going to Atabus, which I have to check my notes here. Notes. Atabus is, I hope, on here. Okay, it's number 8, which is here, I believe. Yeah, it should be 9. Yeah. That's 10, this is 8. Engage, Mr. Sulu.
Alien ship in sensor range. I detect one Klingon battlecruiser on a parallel course.
Oh no, I don't want one.
The Klingon commander is hailing us.
On screen.
Greetings, Enterprise. Welcome to Atabus. I am Captain Klar.
What are you doing? And I am Captain Kirk. Greetings yourself. I take it that this is not your vessel.
It's not his vessel.
What are you doing here? And I am Captain Kirk. Greetings yourself.
I appreciate your courtesy, Captain. I wish to inform you that we mean the colonists no harm.
Good.
You have my word that I intend to take no action against them. As you know, this is neutral space. I have as much right to be here as you. If you do not question this right, I believe that we are capable of bridging any misunderstandings that might arise in this delicate situation. I have always admired the Federation's diplomatic abilities.
Oh, thank you.
I believe we both have more important matters on our minds. Until later, Captain.
Well, it never rains but pours. Mr. Sulu, take us into a parallel course with the alien ship.
Aye, aye, Captain.
Da-da. Cool.
Sensors appear to be experiencing malfunctions. Fascinating. Some anomalous readings are reoccurring. That would indicate that the ship itself is changing in unexpected ways.
That's strange.
I have no explanation for the phenomenon. I have found at least one area that is suitable for transport.
Well, I guess that's where we're going.
No response from the alien ship, sir. Perhaps their communication system is malfunctioning? The Klingons regret that they are too busy to resume communications at this time.
Either that or they do not wish to answer, or they're dead. And there's the Klingon ship. Interesting how it shows up on our radar outside of combat. Can we find anything about this Klar guy? Nope. Alright, then let us save the game again.
Save new game. Replace pre-
And, yeah. Shields down.
We must first leave orbit, sir.
It's not shields then. Just
lowering shields, Captain.
There you go.
We're beaming aboard the alien vessel. Have Dr. McCoy meet us in the transporter. Spock, come with me. Lieutenant Uhura, if its communication system is malfunctioning, then we'll need you.
Yes, Captain.
Mr. Scott, you have the con.
Interesting. McCoy, Spock, and Uhura. I like it. Okay, this guy's catatonic or having a panic attack or something. You okay?
Grinagog watches everything, eyes shining brightly. His legs are pulled up off the floor and he hugs his knees. An enormous grin never leaves his face. This person is staring at the surface of the table in front of him, blinking from time to time. His complexion is sallow and he seems tired. He never looks up, but occasionally flicks away a speck of dust from the otherwise spotless table.
So these people appear to have gone insane by whatever they were doing here, I guess? I'm not sure.
A potted plant. A comfortable-looking room suited for small gatherings of people.
Yeah.
An ordinary-looking table, utterly free of even a trace of dust on its upper surface.
It's very important, you understand.
A set of books. A comfortable-looking room suited for a simple sliding door of reasonable dimensions for a person to walk through.
Hmm.
A potted plant.
What's this thing next to the plant?
A potted plant.
Oh, well.
A table.
It's a table. Looks like part of a table.
A potted plant.
Alright, very sparse descriptions. Okay.
Captain Kirk, proud leader of men and women braving the unknown reaches of space.
Or woman.
He hopes to find the way to prevent this ship from landing on the Atabus colony town. And he's dubious about what he sees in this room.
Hmm.
Although in some ways the epitome of the old-time country doctor, Dr. McCoy hasn't seen evidence of this kind of thing since med school.
Mm-hmm.
The wise-looking science officer raises an eyebrow, wondering if there is some rational explanation for what appears to be quite irrational.
Well, you can rationalize insanity, being insane yourself is living in a state of irrationality.
The sharp-eyed communications officer prepares herself for anything, her dark gaze watchful.
What'd they call her?
The sharp-eyed communications...
Sharp-eyed communications officer. Cool.
We have to find a way to help these people.
I find the situation in this room disturbingly irrational at first impression, Captain. I suggest we endeavor to understand what we see around us in order to make a sensible analysis.
I've made my analysis. Either these guys are experiencing some other kind of reality, or they're just going crazy. Or they're on drugs, either one.
Captain, individuals on this ship appear to be suffering, perhaps from certain mental disorders. Were I to examine them, I might be able to determine something more.
We are going to do that.
Captain, this place gives me the willies. I feel like I'm on a yellow alert without knowing why.
Hmm.
Nothing to report, Captain.
Interesting. The plant does not register in the Tricorder's botany file. But it does suggest similarities to Algolian crocus.
Algolian crocus? Isn't Algol 3 the system with the semi-intelligent plant life?
Affirmative, Doctor. There are characteristics of similar developments in this planet, but on a more limited scale.
Are they releasing spores that affect these gentlemen in some way?
Interesting. The plant does not register in the Tricorder's botany file. But it does suggest similarities to a Shasthar tree on the planet Beta 3.
It's beautiful, Mr. Spock.
Hmm.
Interesting. The plant does not register in the Tricorder's botany file, but it does suggest similarities to a Mnemocynian cactus.
The ones that can shoot thorns at people?
Only three varieties of that plant can shoot thorns, Doctor. Nor do I detect that ability from this specimen.
Well, I don't think these dangerous plants here are a coincidence.
Bound paper records in an alien language, Captain.
Hmm. Analyze everything.
I detect nothing unusual about this table, Captain.
About that table? Very clean.
This person seems typical of his race and unremarkable, except for his fixed stare.
I don't want to analyze the person. Let's try down here. Well, look at the table.
The table is a sturdy construct of manufactured organic and inorganic products. 0.7366 meters high, 2.2 meters wide, and 4.641 meters long. In short, there's nothing special about it.
That's what you think. And they say I'm the crazy one.
Huh. Rabe said that, huh?
person seems normal for his race, if perhaps slightly agitated.
There's a shirt here.
A simple construction of various metals and plastics, half a meter wide at the base and seat.
Not a shirt?
A comfortable looking room suited for a sturdy, simple chair.
Oh, it's a chair. Well, it's part of a chair. I don't even know.
A comfortable looking room. A comfortable looking.
Alright, so have McCoy look at the plants and people.
This plant seems healthy, Jim. This plant seems healthy, Jim.
What about this one? Is this one healthy?
This plant seems healthy, Jim.
They're all healthy, and the humans not so much.
His mental activity is very high, but doesn't seem pathologic, Jim. Respiratory activity indicates a high degree of anxiety by comparison with others of his race. Now, that much stress is unhealthy if this is a chronic state.
What about him?
Slightly undernourished, sluggish pulmonary and circulatory conditioning. Doesn't get nearly enough exercise, I'd say. Brainwave activity uneven. I'd need a battery of tests to be sure. This is a complete new race after all, but he may be suffering from some blood chemistry imbalances likely to be affecting his mind.
Is that what they are? Did I miss something? They're an entirely new race?
Save new game.
Let's save a new game. There's a door here, but let's see if there's something down this way. Yes. Well, hello.
Captain, we have just been thoroughly and efficiently scanned.
Please identify yourself.
Oh.
You haven't been in to see me before, have you?
I'm Captain James T. Kirk, commanding the USS Enterprise. These others are my crew. Science Officer Spock, Lieutenant Uhura, and Dr. McCoy. Who are you?
We are the Faith.
Faith.
Did not your parents speak of me?
Captain, note that it identifies itself only erratically in the singular I, and a blend of voices typifies its communication.
Hive mind?
Suggesting it is a hive mind, Mr. Spock? Or is the voice synthesizer simply programmed for a harmonic chord of voices?
Inconclusive. It may also be that an array of otherwise independent machines have been linked to provide the requisite computing power, although that is an antique and unsophisticated method of achieving this level of intelligence at odds with the overall level of sophistication and evidence. I suggest we pay close attention to both its actions and its words.
Faith, why would our parents have spoken of you?
I am here to care for all of you, Kirk.
Oh?
It is easier for me to care for you when you are younger, but sometimes one's parents are forgetful.
Huh.
We understand. I will care for you now. You will feel better after you eat.
Great. A food-fixating mothering computer. It could, in fact, be very much that.
Faze, you're about to land on a planet inhabited by sentience in the middle of a settlement. If you are in control of this vessel, you must stop. You must not land there.
You will feel better after you eat, dear.
Oh, my.
Run along now. I'm very busy.
The tricorder informs me that the Klingon boarding crew has just beamed into the adjacent room, Captain.
The one we came from? Hello?
You are Kirk. I am Kla, Captain of the Paul-Ya. This is my aide.
These Klingons are so innovative in their introductions.
I'm Captain James T. Kirk, commanding the USS Enterprise. These are my crew, Science Officer Spock, Lieutenant Uhura,
more introductions.
Dr. McCoy. What can I do for you, Captain Clark?
You can avoid interfering with me or my man as we look around the ship, the same as you. And with the same air of mutual goodwill, we will avoid interfering with your activities. Unless we have cause to think your actions in some way threaten us or the Empire we represent.
We do not threaten the Klingon Empire, Captain Klar, nor its legitimate representatives.
Then there will be no difficulties between us, will there?
I hope not.
We will leave you to your investigations now and carry on our own. You won't mind if we're in the room, will you?
We'd consider it a mark of our mutual respect, Captain, if you don't get in our way and we won't get in yours.
They're gonna get in our way. Guaranteed.
Captain Kirk is angered by the destruction evident in this room and determined to get to the bottom of it.
You will endeavor to do so.
The science officer seems quite fascinated with the column of lights in the middle of the room. Dr. McCoy feels sharp concern for the well-being of the collapsed woman. Lieutenant Uhura seems particularly dismayed by the damage done to the device built into the wall.
Because she only cares about communications, I guess.
A column of iridescent sparkles and shimmers, punctuated by floating bubbles of colored light, dances around and within a barely visible central support frame. Gazing at it relaxes you and brings a mild but pleasant sense of peace and calm.
Don't let it control you.
A female of middle age is seated against one wall. Her arms lie limply by her sides, and her legs are outstretched.
She looks older than that.
The aspect of a discarded rag doll. She is completely motionless as she stares into middle distance, focused on nothing.
Middle distance, huh?
The guts of this machinery have been torn from the wall, leaving broken plastic and bent metal dangling. It doesn't look like it will ever work again.
Sorry, Uhura.
The room's most captivating feature is a strange column of lights in the middle of the room. However, it's evident that people unknown came through and severely damaged everything they could. Evidently, they didn't hesitate to hurt one of their own people, either. The room's most
Looks like someone's left graffiti here. There's nothing else to look at but this, and this, and her? Just trying to see if there's anything else. Like anything we can take, anything we can look at. Mousing over crap and yeah.
This computer is psychologically unstable. I wonder if illogic.
Captain, this computer shows no attention to logical principles. Therefore, I must conclude that demonstrations of illogic would have little impact upon it. I find the room fascinating, Captain. Worthy of close examination in every regard. I would suggest that Dr. McCoy examine the woman lying on the floor.
Get into it.
That woman appears to need medical attention.
Someone seems to have been quite indiscriminate about damaging everything they could reach in here.
There is no response at all. Not even a flicker of attention crosses the person's eyes.
That's right, I don't think we tried talking to the other two. I figured we wouldn't get much help. So there's not a lot of things to analyze, let's just analyze this.
An extremely complex mechanical construct, Captain. Readings indicate this is a functional AI, an artificial intelligence of considerable sophistication. It may not be in perfect condition, however. Certain power shunts may be repair solutions to malfunctioning subsets.
It sounds like you're saying there's scar tissue. Where the machine healed old damage.
Precisely, Doctor.
Well, they actually can understand each other. Sometimes.
There are a number of life forms to be found throughout the ship. This machinery appears to have been a read-only computer terminal. The configuration and construction is unique, to say the least, from what I can make out. It is utterly destroyed, beyond any hope of repair.
From Uhura's reaction, I thought it was a communication device.
The person is typical of her race, but seems to be functioning below optimal levels.
You know, another thing, we didn't try to cure those people either.
She's cataleptic, Jim. Completely submerged within her mind. Completely withdrawn from external stimuli. If I were to put her arm up in the air, it would stay there until I moved it back down.
Psychological damage or something physical?
I can't be sure, even with rather extensive tests. But from the tricorder readings, I would say some psychological shock ruptured an inherently fragile cognitive structure. In ancient times, they would have said she was skittish or prone to a nervous breakdown or weak-minded. There are a myriad of childhood developmental blind alleys that might restrict her adult pattern creation representation cap.
Bone, stop. You're starting to sound like Spock.
He couldn't say the line. You hear that? He started messing up the line like he was laughing. Did you hear that?
She's cataleptic, Jim.
Psychological damage or something physical?
I can't be sure, even with rather extensive tests. But from the tricorder readings, I would say
pattern
some
creation representational capabilities for Lord
cognitive structure.
Critical horizon.
In ancient times, they would have said she was skittish or prone to a nervous breakdown.
Listen.
Weak-minded. There are a myriad of childhood developmental blind alleys that might restrict her adult pattern creation representation cap.
Bone, stop. You're starting to sound like Spock.
You do not have to be insulting, Captain.
Yeah, you hear that. Can we, help her?
I'm sorry, Jim, but I'm not willing to experiment with the drugs I'm carrying to see what might or might not work, especially given her condition. I'm afraid I'd be as likely to kill her as affect any positive change.
Yeah, I had a feeling. Still, had to try.
You believe this was some kind of electronic device, a reader or computer interface, but it looks completely destroyed.
Now you have to walk all the way back.
We appreciate your desire to become one with me, but it is impossible. Despite what you may think, this is no short route to Godhead.
Gay.
Are you suggesting I attempt a Vulcan mind meld, Captain?
It does seem an appropriate effort in this circumstance.
Oh, cool.
Take me a moment to prepare myself. Doctor, please monitor her life signs. The procedure does entail some risk.
Not only to her, but to you too. Am I right?
I assure you, Doctor, I will retain sufficient distance to avoid being dragged into something from which I cannot withdraw.
Go ahead now, Spock.
Yeah, be careful. You don't want a human black hole mind.
Puzzlewit. I am the one who reads it all.
I wasn't even planning this.
Understand. I try. I read it all. So many ideas. Always jumbled. Cannot make sense of. Puzzlewit wants to know. Hope to discover why I try to remember it all. Then Tuscan comes in. He destroys me, my hopes, all broken, all shattered. Oh. I'm broken in countless pieces.
Doctor?
No physical injuries, Captain. Not to him or to her.
Tuscan's scared of me. Scared. I know, but I don't know.
You don't know.
I don't understand.
Me neither.
Nothing connects to anything else. I want to know it all. Hope then I'll understand. He thinks I'll hurt him. I don't hurt anybody. I just want to know more.
It's commendable.
Now, I only know what I know.
Makes sense.
Never know what Puzzlewitch doesn't know anymore.
What's going on here?